to youth doing stuff. If you're a visitor, there's a little thing in your bulletin that you can fill out, and you could if you could tear that off and drop it in the offering plate, we'd love to have your information. We have some announcements today. We have a new discovery class, and it met this morning. And if you missed it this morning, you can still come next week. It's at 9:30 in room 210 on Sunday. We have two guests to help us lead worship. Our worship leader's name is James, and he's from High Point, North Carolina. He's a sophomore at North Greenville, and he's majoring in Christian studies. And then our sermon will be led by Jody Jennings. He's married to Emily Jennings, and they have four children. They've served with the International Mission Board in Uganda and the North American Mission Board. He's now the BSU director at North Greenville. Please take some time to greet one another.
If you guys want to join me in worship this morning, we're going to, if you want to use your hymn book, we'll be in hymn 98, Come Thou Fount. And so 95, I think it's 95 or 98, one of the two. So if the words get wrong, you can flip a few pages over. I stopped playing. Okay, let's worship. Come Thou Fount of every blessing. To my heart to sing thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above, praise the mountain. Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus saw me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, he to rest. From take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
My name is Taft, and I'm reading 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1 through 5. God laid this passage on my heart, so I'm going to read it to y'all. You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times, for people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that can make them godly. Stay away from people like that. All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, be with us all, and thank you for this wonderful day. And Jesus, just be with all of us, and just please let you show our light and guide us to the holy part of anything you can, dear Heavenly Father. And just be with us all, and be with all the people who are blessing you today inside the youth. And be with my sister while she sings, and please let she just be very uplifting and godly to all the people that are listening. Please guide them to godly and all they can. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let us pray.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us all here together today. And we pray for all the soldiers in Iraq, and we pray for everyone that is here today and everything that's weighing on everybody's hearts. And you know what's on their hearts, and even before we do. And we pray that you would open up everybody's hearts today to seek your face and to come to know you more, and even if they know you, to come to know you better. And in your name we pray, amen. Will the children please come for the children's sermon?
How many of y'all went trick-or-treating last night? Y'all like candy? Well, today we're going to talk about Revelation 3:20. It says, "Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come and eat with him, and he with me." When you go trick-or-treating, you go up to people's door and ring on it. Well, God comes to our door and knocks on it and all we have to do is open the door and accept God's gift, which is eternal life. And it's better than candy, because candy just lasts while you eat it, but God's gift lasts forever. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us come out here today, and let's worship you, and let's have a good weekend, and keep us safe throughout the week. In Jesus' name, amen.
As I play this next song, we worship together. This is Jesus Paid It All, and it's probably a familiar hymn to you, but I'm going to play another little part at the end that you may not have heard before, and that part just goes, "Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead." And, you know, as we sing that, I want you guys to just remember, you know, what Christ did when he paid for our sin. He gives us the opportunity to receive his righteousness. And Isaiah 1:18 says, "Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool." You know, that's what Christ does for us. And so, you know, just stand with me and join in worship as we worship God and praise him for that fact.
Savior say, "Thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in thee thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power. left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Sing that again. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Dear Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for your many blessings. I pray for the offering that we're about to receive, and I pray that we come here today with open hearts and open minds so that we'll learn more about you and we can take it throughout the week and use it in our lives to become better Christians. Thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross for our sins, and thank you so much. In your holy name, amen.
She never slows down. She doesn't know why, but she knows that when she's all alone, feels like it's all coming down. She won't turn around. The shadows.
This next song we're going to sing is probably not familiar to most of you, so you guys can just remain seated for this song, and I welcome you to join and sing and stand if you would like, but really just I want you to reflect on these words. me try that again. I gotta get the note. Okay, I got it.
Before the world was made, before you spoke it to be, you were the King of Kings. Yes, you were. Yes, you were. And now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them as we sing. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. Forever we sing. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. Forever. You gave me breath so I could praise your great and matchless name. All my days, let my whole life be a blazing offering, a life that shouts and sings the greatness of the King. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever.
Pray together. Lord Jesus, we do thank you this morning for what you are doing, what you will do, and how you continue to speak into our lives truth from your word. Lord, I thank you for these students. Thank you for, Lord, the fact of the matter that all of us have abilities. Lord, regardless of our age, regardless of where we're at in our spiritual journeys, God, you desire that we would be used by you. I thank you for each one of these students, that they've been able to declare your praise through different ways and different things that they've done and said and sung and all of that. Lord, we thank you for that. And we pray that in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. I want to take just a brief moment, and that's a heavy music stand right there. I want to take just a brief moment and kind of thank you guys for letting us have the time to be here this morning. Thank you for letting your students. In fact, you students, would you guys go ahead and stand up for me? Can you go ahead and do that for me? All you students, go ahead and stand up. I think you guys sat down fast. I think it's when you look and you see these students, the fact of the matter is that they are what's coming. They are the church. They are as much a part of you now as they will be in the future. And I wholeheartedly thank you. Thank you, Northgate Baptist Church, for being willing to set aside a Sunday morning where these students can say, hey, you know what? We are part of the body of Christ. We're not just somebody who's stuck over in a room somewhere. We're not just, you know, an addition, but we are part of the body of Christ. So often today, there's so many students who attend church and are part of the church, and yet they miss the fact and don't see that they are part of the body of Christ. So I really, really applaud you and thank you for that. I thank you for your willingness to do that for them. So thank you on behalf of them. Thank you on behalf of the church, all of it all together. So That's where I want to start. Let me introduce myself. I get a little excited and carried away. So this morning, if I talk real fast, you have to listen real fast because I got a lot to say. But I want to tell you a little bit about myself, because sometimes when you see a guy standing up, you say, man, that's not our pastor, and I'm definitely not your pastor. He's much better looking than I am. So, amen? Amen? All right. Amen or oh me, whichever one. But my name is Jody Jennings, and I have the privilege to be the Baptist Student Union Director at North Greenville University. I know some of our students come over here on Wednesdays to help with some of your students, and it's just a thrill to be part of a place where our motto is, where Christ makes the difference, and it really is an exciting place to be. North Greenville, on behalf of North Greenville, I would like to say thank you to you as well. Part of your cooperative program giving, when you give to the offering, part of that goes to support the cooperative program, which in turn supports North Greenville University. So I thank you. You help pave the way for me. You are a blessing to my life. And my wife and kids, thank you for that as well. I have one wife and four kids. Don't get that confused. I have one wife and four kids. Emily, we've been married 9 years now. We were married in 2000, so it makes it really easy for me to remember how many years I've been married. Okay, 2000. Okay, well, 9 years. I've been married 9 years, and we have four kids. We have Silas, who is 6 years old. We have Hattie, who is 4 years old. Luke, who is three. And Millie Grace, who is about to be one. She'll be one the end of November. So, needless to say, life is crazy around my house. But in the midst of all of it, I have the opportunity just to hang out with students like James and Michael and be a part of seeing God do some incredible stuff. Because in case you didn't know, I want to inform you that God is continuing to do remarkable things with students across this country. Particularly at North Greenville, I see it over and over. I have students come in my office all the time who say, man, let me tell you what God's doing. Let me share with you how God's placed in my life a burden to reach people in places that you and I probably never will go. That they have a desire to see lives changed in ways that you and I maybe never even dreamed about, to go to hard places, difficult places. And you know what? They're counting on us to say, hey, let's support them. Let's be behind them. And again, that's why I thank you for doing things like you do today. I want to talk today and kind of move in the direction of Romans chapter 12. If you have your Bibles, you can go ahead and turn there. Romans chapter 12 is where we will be. A very, very familiar passage. A passage that if you've attended church for any period of time, you've probably heard before. You've probably walked through this in Sunday school. You've probably talked about this. But I want to give us fresh eyes to see something that's contained within this passage. Because I've seen too many people grow accustomed to familiar passages and miss the heart of what it is. Very much like my mom. My mom has this T-shirt that says, if I had known grandchildren were this much fun, I would have had them first. And I say, Mom, wait a minute, what about me? She forgets all about me, and she just wants to see her grandkids. And sometimes through the commonplace, just hearing it, seeing it, walking through it, we forget about some things. And that's what I want to call your attention to this morning. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2 is where we'll be. And I want to speak directly. I want to give you up front the main concept or idea of what I want to talk about. I want to talk about us being living sacrifices. It's the phrase that's contained within the verses, Romans chapter 12, being living sacrifices. I don't want to miss words. I want to be very clear, because sometimes we have a mix-up of things. I saw phrases the other day that I looked at, and I said, man, what exactly does that mean? And I don't want to confuse you this morning. I saw a sign the other day that said, clean dirt. And I said, clean dirt. I thought to myself, what is clean? I mean, I know what it means, but I thought, man, that's kind of correct. Clean dirt. What exactly does that mean? I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and he said, well, this girl was almost pregnant. And I thought to myself, okay. I saw something in a restaurant. I saw a sign that said daily special. I thought, daily special. If it's every day, then it's really special. Daily special. And there's these phrases. My favorite for you students here, my favorite one of all, is cafeteria food. The stuff they serve, it doesn't connect. That's not really food. I remember looking at my lunchroom and thinking, what is that? I don't know. There's so many phrases and things that I get confused about, but I want to be very, very clear this morning very, very clear and not confuse you about what I'm talking about. I'm talking about us being living sacrifices. Romans chapter 12 will be in verses 1 and 2 and a few more following. Let me turn there real quick. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Let me go back to verse number 1, and that's where we're going to camp out for just a second. I'm going to make it real simple. Therefore, I urge you, in view of God's mercy. Paul is writing to the people in Rome, the people who have professed and become followers of Jesus. He's writing to them. Just basic Bible knowledge for you students. If you look in the Bible, oftentimes in the New Testament, there's some letters that have been written, like Romans, for example. It's written to the people who are living in Rome, who are known as Romans. So when you read the book of Romans, you know that this is written to people who were Romans. The same is when you look in Galatians, there's the book of Galatians, the New Testament. You guys know that? This means yes, this means no? All right, we're good to go. Galatians, it's written to people who were living in the city of Galatia, so they were Galatians. So when you go through the New Testament, you can sound really smart. You can tell people, hey, look, this was written to people in this place, and this is what they were called. Just basic Bible knowledge for you, right? Right on. All right, so written to people in Rome who were followers of Jesus. I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy. Now, I've got to be who I am, okay? And I don't know how you guys normally do things around here, so just forgive me. But I really enjoy what, kind of a dialogue, not just a monologue, but a dialogue. So if I ask a question, I really like for you to talk back to me. So I want to ask a simple question this morning. What do you see, or can you give me an example? I'm going to start with you students over here, because I know all the adults have all the answers, and I'm going to start with you guys. When you think of the word mercy, what picture comes to mind, or what thought comes into being right now? Somebody give me an answer. Forgiveness. It's a very good thing. Holding back. Like when you play the game Mercy. You want to play now? No? Okay. When you hold back, holding back what? Holding back? Anger. Holding back anger. That's a very, very good, man. That's very insightful. Mercy. Somebody else. What comes to mind when you think of mercy? Compassion? Grace? Undeserved. Something that's been given to you when you don't really deserve it. I think the amazing thing to me is that when I see mercy in my life and when I see how God has revealed mercy over and over and over and over again, I see it. It's not just one time. It's not just occasionally, but it's continual. In view of God's mercies. Now what is the ultimate mercy that God has shown us? I think it's found in Romans, a very, again, very, very familiar verses that we would know. Romans 3:23. And I think, again, we just need to run back to some very, very familiar things that we know, to understand what Paul is saying when he's writing to these Romans. Romans verse 23 in chapter 3 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And then again in chapter 6, we're just kind of walking through the Romans road here. Chapter 6, verse number 23 says what? Says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." What is the ultimate mercy for us? And I hope you see it. I hope you've experienced in your life this morning the ultimate mercy is that we, all of us, you, I, all, your pastor, Blue, your student pastor, all of us have done wrong things and stand in place of deserving God's judgment. All of us have sinned. If you've sinned, would you raise your hand this morning? Man, that's so good. If you didn't raise your hand, you just lied, so you sinned again. But all of us have done wrong things. Some of us more than others. And all you wives can put your husband and say, he's talking about you this morning. All of us have done wrong things. But the beautiful thing is the mercy, the thing that makes grace so amazing is that even though we sin and deserve God's wrath, even though that's us, man, God made a way for us to not experience God's judgment. And that is through the person of Jesus. See, we talk about Jesus a lot. We hear about Jesus a lot. But I want you to see that Jesus is more than just a man who lived and died and was buried and rose again. But He is God in the flesh who came and took God's wrath for us. Man, there is no more greater mercy than that. My dad, I grew up in the middle part of Georgia. My dad would say, man, that's so good you can sop it up with a biscuit. I mean, that is good right there. The best way that I know how to illustrate that, I'm going to need a few volunteers. You can come on up here. Daniel, you can come up here. You can come up here, Hudson Taylor, the great missionary. The best way that I can illustrate this is that there's a great divide in our life. For the wages of sin is death. Okay? And what I want you to see is that, I want you to imagine this morning, and work with me here. I want you to imagine that here is man. We're here living on earth. And past the back pew back there, just past the back pew, is eternal life with God. Just imagine with me for just a moment. And we're standing, and in between here and there is death. In between here, us, man, and eternal life with God is death. And I want you to imagine this morning, you look like, what's your name?
Bradley.
Bradley looks like a very, very fit young man this morning. Bradley, what I'd like you to do is I would like you to stand here. Come right here with me. I'd like you to stand right here, and I'd like you to jump in one jump. I'd like you to jump from here to eternal life with God. Think you can do it? Give it a try. Okay, stand right there. That's good, that's good. You made it pretty. Three pews, all right. Daniel, come here. What I want you to do is I want you to mark your spot, make sure that he can't outdo you. I want you to make it to eternal life. One jump now, okay? You ready? Go ahead. That's pretty good. You guys are both pretty athletic guys, man. That's an excellent job. And what we see is that, what I want you to see is that you, in your best effort, taking his shoes off. Did y'all notice that? What I want you to see is that in their best effort, that's great. I love it. High five. In their best effort, they can only attain to a certain degree. Even if we got the greatest athlete in all times, if we found the long jumper of all time, the long jumper of long jumpers, whoever it would be, it's impossible for that individual to jump from there to eternal life with God. You follow me there? But see, so often I'm trying not to make y'all dizzy walking back and forth. We try with different things to make it to God. We try good works. Man, if I can just work harder, if I can attend church every week, if I can pray a little bit harder, if I can read my Bible more, man, if I can just do good things to a lot of people, then maybe I can get to eternal life with God. But you know what? The fact of the matter is we fall short every time. See, so many times we try different stuff. We look at different ways, but the truth of the matter is that even in our best effort, we fall short. There's only one way that you and I can get to eternal life with God. There's only one way. It's not through our works. Come here, Hudson. It's not through our works. It's not through anything that we do. Okay, you're going to stand here, and on the count of three, you're going to jump up. You ready? One, two, three. It's not through anything that we do. But rather, the only way is that you could be carried through death. You're getting heavy, buddy. The only way that you could see it. Stand right here. And he raises his hands in victory. The only way that you can see it is that when Jesus comes and carries us from separation from that death, let's walk back, from that death to eternal life with Him. There is no way that you and I can earn it. There is no way that you and I can deserve it. But it's only through Jesus. Give these guys a big, big hand. And I really, really want to encourage you this morning. And I go to great lengths to try and help you see. Hey, Jose, good to see you. Go to great lengths for you to see that there is no way. There is no way apart from a relationship with Jesus that you can experience eternal life with Him. And I think in my experience of talking with students across the country in Uganda, my wife and I had the privilege of serving with the International Mission Board in Uganda in the eastern part of Africa. In my experience there, I talked to so many young people. I talked to so many middle-aged people. I talked to so many old people. I talked to across the board, and so many people, when you ask them, how do you know that you can have eternal life? The answer seems to go to a works-based salvation. And I fear that in our churches today and in the culture in which we live here in the Southeast, that there are so many people who are banking their eternal life not on a relationship with Jesus that He's carried them from death to life, but on the fact that maybe they prayed a prayer, or maybe that they grew up in the church, or maybe they got baptized at a certain age, and they're basing eternity on something apart from Jesus. I'm going to give you an opportunity. If you find yourself in that place this morning, I want to give you an opportunity here in just a few moments to recognize and realize and verbalize to God, God, I see that I need forgiveness. I don't need some works. But I need true forgiveness found in the person of Jesus. I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that here in just a few moments. See, I urge you, just like Paul did, I urge you, brothers, by God's mercy, that you would do what? Look at it next. That you would present your bodies a living sacrifice. What's that look like? What does it mean? I mean, we talk about being a living sacrifice. See, the problem with living sacrifices is that they always climb off the altar, right? It's very easy for them to, man, I'm getting out of here. It's not easy for us to lay our lives down. See, what does that look like? It looks just like the following verses in Romans chapter 12, that you would offer your bodies, living sacrifices, what? Holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Watch it here. How do we do that? What's that look like? Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Do not conform, but be transformed. What does it look like to be a living sacrifice? It means that you are no longer being squeezed into or pressed into the mold that the world has for you. That you are resisting and standing against, just like you saw through interpretive movement, that you're standing against what the enemy would want to try and squeeze you into. See, some of us, you know, the longer I'm saved, the harder it is for me to remember what it was like when I was lost. And so oftentimes it just kind of gets to be just kind of, yeah, I sing this song and I do church, but you remember what it was like, man, before you place your faith in Jesus, when life was miserable and you had no hope and the world was continuing to press in on you, and you just continued to give in and you continued to give in. Even now, maybe for some of us, as we have grown in our faith, but we still face the enemy who comes and tries to conform us, tries to shape us and think this, say this, respond like this, try to control this, try and manipulate this situation. Don't trust God. You can't really trust God with your finances. I mean, in the economy we live in, can you really trust God with your finances? Can you really give to ministries? Can you tithe through the church? Man, don't do that. I don't want to meddling now. I'm sorry. Can you really? But don't conform. Don't allow the world to dictate who you will be, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now I want to do something that may be a little risky this morning, but I think it'll be valuable for you. The best way that I know to renew your mind, the best way to hit delete, and the best way to enter something new in is to get rid of one thing and put something else in. And if you're going to get rid of the wrong thoughts and the wrong motives, if you're going to get rid of that, you can't just, let me get rid of it, and and leave it out, but you got to replace it with something. Renewing your mind. The best way that I know to renew your mind is to be in the Scriptures, to be in the Word of God. We say we believe this, right? The B-I-B-L-E, yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. Bible, we all yell. We say we believe the Bible, but how many of us truly, truly absorb the Bible and read it on a regular basis and imagine, memorize the Bible? That's for the kids, you know. We need to help them memorize when they're little kids. What about us? What about you, students? When you're facing temptation at school and the world's trying to press you into its mold and want you to act this certain way, man, how can you resist that? How can you not conform to that, but rather be transformed by the renewing of your mind? It's through the Word of God. And I'm not trying to give you some legalistic, if you're not doing this, then you're bad and you're terrible and God doesn't love you. I'm not saying that at all, but I think it's imperative for us as the church, as the followers of Jesus, who say we stand upon this Word and we fight for it and we say we don't want anybody to mess with the Bible. I think it's important for us, if we believe the Bible, to know what the Bible says. So here's what I want to do this morning, because I talked to so many people who say they believe the Bible, but don't know very many verses of Scripture. Say, man, give me five. Watch this. Here it is. I'm not going to get you to do this out loud. I just want you to think. How many of you think you could, don't raise your hand, how many of you think you could say five verses from memory right now? Don't raise your hand. I'm not going to ask you to do it. Just think. Could you do five verses? Then think. That's good. You can sit down then. That's good. I know you could do five, Bo. What about, now watch this, if we all stood up, or if we all did that, but I don't want to call anybody else. What if I said 10? What if I said 20 from memory, 20 verses? What if I said 50? Could we do 50 verses from memory? You know, I think, man, that's a tough, tough thing, right? We say we believe it, but do we really? Because if we believed it, wouldn't we want to continue to be in it? And many of us, all of us, in fact, I would say, need to aspire to know more of the Word of God. So here's what I want to do. I want to get us to memorize a verse so that when you walk out, you can say, you know what? That's not too bad. That's not so hard. Man, I can't memorize. I talk to people, I can't memorize. Do you know how old I am? I can't memorize. I forgot what today is. I mean, I'm lucky that I remember to set my clock backwards. Now, if it had been forward, it would have been a different story, but I did remember to set it backwards. But memorizing Scripture is not a difficult thing. How do you eat an elephant one bite at a time if you memorize it chunk by chunk, little bit by little bit? So here's what I'm going to do. I want to ask you, this may seem juvenile. It may seem, man, this really is the youth service, maybe the kids service, but I want you to follow me here because I want you to see that you can do it, all right? I want you to repeat after me. Psalm 119:72. Psalm 119:72. Psalm 119:72. The law from your mouth. Psalm 119:72. Wait. Psalm 119:72. All right. Psalm 119:72. The law from your mouth is more precious to me. Psalm 119:72. Psalm 119:72, the law from your mouth is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold. Psalm 119:72. Psalm 119:72, the law from your mouth is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold. Psalm 119:72. All right, somebody, say it. Youth, one of you guys. Come on. 72. Good. Adult. Some adult say it for me. Psalm 119:72. Go ahead.
Psalm 119:72.
Law.
The law from your mouth is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold. Psalm 119:72.
Excellent. Somebody else? Anybody else? You can clap. That's right. You kept your shoes on. You're good. Somebody else. One more person. Excellent. Now let me ask you guys a question. Did you know that verse before you came this morning? Did you know it? Okay. So none of them, probably most of us in this room, didn't know that verse before we came. But right now, how many of you could say Psalm 119:72, the law from your mouth is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold? Probably the majority of us. And that took us approximately, I'm guessing right now, took us approximately maybe 4 to 5 minutes. Man, I can't memorize. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. It's just a matter of saying, you know what, Lord? I don't want to conform any longer to the patterns of this world. I don't want to be like I used to be. But rather, I want to be transformed by the renewing of my mind. I want to take some time, Lord. I want to put it on a sticky note on my desk, on my computer. And when I look, I say, Psalm 119:72, the law from your mouth is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold. I want to memorize it. Why? So when I'm tempted and when I have difficulties and I'm being pressed in, I can say, you know what, that's not who I am, but rather I want to be transformed through your scriptures. God, I want to put it down, and when I sit down to eat my lunch today, I want to have a reminder, Psalm 119:72, so that I can, God, be transformed by the renewing of my mind. You know, I never sat in a church service in my life where anybody, I was probably encouraged to learn scripture, but I never sat in any service where anybody ever said to me, hey, here's how you can do it, here's a very simple thing. And see, man, it's just little bit by little bit, and little bit by little bit adds up to a lot. And I really want to encourage you guys, in view of God's mercy, in view of what He did for you, that you and I stand in need of forgiveness and that it's only through the person of Jesus, that you would recognize and see that, if that's true of your life, that you've placed your faith in Jesus, that you would see, you know what, I don't want to conform any longer. And that looks different for every one of you. But I want to be transformed, and that you would be aggressive in being transformed by the renewing of your mind. I said earlier that I wanted to give you, if you didn't understand, or if you had placed your faith in something apart from the forgiveness that's only found through the person of Jesus, I said that I wanted to give you an opportunity to make that right today. And I want to do that. I want to help you see that it's very simple. Salvation is a free gift. It cost Jesus His very life, but it's a free gift offered to you and to me. And I urge you that you would give your life to Him today. And you can do that very simply this morning. It's not something that's hard or difficult. It's just that you would surrender your life, that you would see that you're a sinner, that you've done wrong things. For the wages of sin is death. That all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That you would recognize that and realize it today. But that you would say, you know what, God, I deserve death, but I want to trust you to forgive me for that. I want you to carry me from death to life through what you did on the cross for me. And you believe that what Jesus did was make atonement for you, that He paid for your sin. Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. And that you would confess that to Him today. And the way that I want to ask you to confess that is just simply by through a simple prayer. It's not a magical prayer. It's not something you can get the words wrong. You can all of that. It's not the prayer, but rather it's your heart that this morning you're crying out and saying, God, I need to be saved. And so I want to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes this morning, everybody here. And I want to ask you this morning if maybe you have never accepted Jesus. You may have come to church a long time. You could even be a founding member of this church or another church. But you see for the first time that, man, I've been trusting a lot of things, but I've never truly trusted Jesus to be my sin bearer, the one who takes away my sin. If that's true of your life today, would you just ask Jesus in a simple prayer that says, Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner and I need you to forgive me, and I'm willing to surrender my life to you. If you would just do that today, I'm going to pray a prayer here in just a minute, just similar to the one that I just said. If you would just repeat that prayer silently in your heart, would you do that today? If that's true of you today, would you pray this prayer? Would you say, Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner and I've done wrong things, but I want to be forgiven, and I believe that Jesus is the one who will take away my sins. Would you just pray that prayer? Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner, that I've done wrong things, but I want to be forgiven, and I believe that Jesus is the one who can take away my sin. Just tell him right now, right where you are. And if you're already a follower of Jesus today, you've surrendered your life to him, but yet you've found yourself in a position where you've been conforming, and you're saying today, you know what, no more of that. No more conforming in my thoughts and in my words and in my actions, but rather being transformed by the renewing of my mind. And today I want to nail it down, and I want to say, Jesus, I want change in my life. Would you just talk to him right where you are and say, Jesus, I want to be transformed by the renewing of my mind. I want the law from your mouth to be more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver or gold. Just for another moment, just you and God. There's lots of people around, but right now it's a moment with just you and him. And I'm not trying to manipulate you. I'm not trying to say, hey, make this emotional or anything. But I want you to do business with God right where you are. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your word. Lord, there's a lot of context that goes with Romans chapter 12 that I didn't dive into and that we could spend a long time on. But this morning, I hope that it was very, very clear. One of your mercy. What is that? That you gave yourself for us. And in light of that, in view of your mercies, that we would give ourselves as living sacrifices, people who no longer conform but are willing to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Lord Jesus, I thank you. I thank you that you are sufficient. And I love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to ask you all to stand, and Blue, if you'll come up here. You can go ahead and stand to your feet. And this morning, if there's any decision that you need to make, this is an invitation time for you to come. And again, I don't know how you guys normally do this, but I'm just going to do what I feel like you can do right now. This is a time for you to formally kind of come and surrender something that you can, because there's something about verbalizing or something about making commitment to where you're saying, and it solidifies some stuff in your life. So I want to ask you this morning, wherever you're at, whatever decision you need to make, you can make it in your seat. But if you just need someone to come and talk to, you need somebody, if you need to come and pray and just outwardly say, hey, here it is. And there's something about an altar where you can come and kneel and say, I'm nailing it down right now. So you guys respond how you want. I'm going to turn it over to Blue, and he'll close us out today. James will sing for us, and then the invitation will be finished.
This is my Father's world, and soon my listening ears, all nature sings, around me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas, his hands these wonders wrought. This is my Father's world, the birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, the
That was awesome.
Thank you, James. Thank you, Jody, for preaching the word. Thank you for leading in worship this morning. Students, thank you for leading in worship this morning. And there's more students in the back who were ushers. Be sure you tell them what a good job they did. And thank you for reminding us Christians of the mercies of God. And thank you for challenging us to memorize Scripture and renew our minds. Thank you for that. And thank you for investing in students at North Greenville. And we praise God for your ministry. We're reaping benefits of that ministry at Northgate every week. And we're thankful for that. There were a couple of students whose names weren't in the bulletin today that were ushers today, Anthony Caparelli and Daniel Mejia. So thank you. I also want to say thanks to John Folk. He worked very hard on our sound this morning. And Joey Hall, that did a good job too. So we're grateful for that. This time, Riley Todd, will you pray for us?
Let us pray. God, thank you for letting us come here today, and thank you for taking care of every one of us here, and could continue to watch over us and make sure that we're all right. And thank you for letting Jody and James come and help lead us today, and thank you for letting us have a wonderful youth service today, and continue to make sure that those in need can get better. Amen.